Follow him, books, and turn to page 75.
Page 75.
It is one of the most highly prophesied events in all the Bible. We're going to look at some of those prophecies that were made. It was a dream age that was dreamed by the Old Testament folks. They talked about the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord was the day when God was going to come back and take over the reins of the world. And this is what happened. Now, they didn't have all the revelation then that we have today. A lot of the revelation, well, most of it came through John on the Isle of Patmos, and his revelation that God revealed to him. So this morning, if you're in Revelation chapter 20, let's look at 10 verses. John said, "And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the keys of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he could not deceive the nations no more, till 1,000 years shall be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosened a little season. And I saw the thrones, and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their forehead or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed is and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sands of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about. And behold the city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that had deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophets are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and forever. The word millennium is not mentioned in the Bible. The word millennium simply means 1,000 years. This is a period of history that Bible scholars over the years gave the title to this section of the millennium reign of Jesus Christ. It would probably have been better if they called it the kingdom age, because in the Old Testament and even in the New Testament, even Jesus' prophecies talked about the kingdom of God. It is a time that men have dreamed about. Now, a lot of religious folks think that we can bring that in by human efforts. Now, human efforts can do a lot of good. Let me not lay that aside and cast shadow on that, because there's a lot of good programs that people do, and the organization does, that makes, and even government does, that makes life better. But the problem we have, folks, is the devil is still here. You could have no millennium reign with the devil on the loose. The first thing God has to do, he has to bind the devil. The angel came down and John said, I saw a chain. I saw a key and I saw a chain. And he laid hand on him and put him in the bottomless pit. He locked the door on him. Now, they locked the door on Jesus, didn't they, when they put him in the tomb? Remember, the Jews said, now look to Pilate, you need to go set a seal on that. You need to roll, you need to be sure that gravestone's not rolled back. You need to put some soldiers there. Now, why do you think God had them to do that? Because that was absolute, without doubt, proof that Jesus resurrected over the dead. It's amazing to me how God uses even ungodly people to work his will in the world. So the millennium reign is that period of time from when Jesus comes back in his glory until the great white throne judgment. A thousand years of millennium reign. Now notice the first thing he has to do is bind Satan. Notice just an angel, an unnamed angel. Not Gabriel, not Michael, just an unnamed angel. You just run the mill every day. Angel came down and took hold of Satan, threw him in the bottomless pit. Isaiah, I'm going to read now from Isaiah chapter 14, and I'm going to begin at verse 12. Talks about the devil. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which doth weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend unto heaven. I will exalt myself, my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the side of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. I'm going to be like God, he said in heart. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. And so ended his career. Now let me tell you, every death you've ever had to suffer through in your lifetime was because of a devil. Every sickness that ever came upon any individual, whether it was a temporary sickness or whether they would die from that sickness, is because of the devil. Every suffering, you ever suffering, whether it be mental suffering, whether it be physical suffering, whether it be emotional suffering, all that came about by the hands of the devil. And now he is locked away for 1,000 years in the bottomless pit. Now let's look at Christ as he sets up his millennium reign. The Bible says that he is spoken of as a prophet, of a priest, and a king. We saw him as a prophet, we saw him as a priest, but not until this time do we see him as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. As a matter of fact, when the angel Gabriel talked to Mary, one of the things he said was that he would set up on the throne of David and rule the nation of Israel. There are so many scriptures. Let me read a few of these scriptures that prophesy about it. After, remember Daniel in his prophecy, he whittles all time in his prophecy theme of 70 weeks. 490 weeks. 70 weeks. And so he whittles it down. They said, after that he said, and they all share in the fullness of the season. In other words, everybody going to be able to take a part of this that's alive in the earth. Ezekiel tells us how the Spirit being poured out on the Jews, the name of the city, that is Jerusalem, is going to be changed. The name of the city, he said to Ezekiel, shall be Jehovah Shammah. Jehovah Shammah, which means the Lord is there. Now Hosea said this, that they, that is the Jews, shall seek his face and be restored from all nations. Now God's let us live to see since 1948, when Israel became a nation again, God's let us live to see that people coming back. But they have not yet gained all the land that God gave them, but they will, because that's part of the prophecy of the Bible. Amos prophesied and said he would have a perfect earth. I've lived under a lot of different presidents, but I don't think I could ever point to one of them and say it was perfect. And yet, during the millennium reign, those that lived that 1,000 years will say we had a perfect ruler. Micah said this, the law shall go out from Zion and the word of God from Jerusalem. Zechariah said this, the broad places of the city shall be full of boys and girls playing in the broad places thereof. You see, during this 1,000-year millennium reign, life will go on as normal, except there won't be any devil. There will still be evil in the hearts of men, but the iron rod, remember the insignia we talked about, God will immediately put it down. Now, when Jesus was here on the earth, he was the poorest of poor. Here's what he said. He said, the beasts of the field, they have the holes. Fowls of the air, they have their nests. They have a place to go. They have a home. But he said, the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He was the poorest of poor. I saw on the internet this morning, I was looking up something here, and one street in Los Angeles, that's usually a back street, had 50 homeless families living on both sides of the road. Jesus was one of those homeless people. But now, he's reigning in glory.
Amen.
When he was sure he was a victim, evil men lied about him and crucified him. But then, he will be victor. Here, he wore a crown of thorns, but there, he'll have a crown of glory. Who's gonna assist him in all this room? Mrs. Fina. Saints of God's gonna assist him. That's something, isn't it? Can you imagine yourself being part of a world government run by God Himself? And notice what Romans says. For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. And Luke says this. And he said unto them, well, thy good servant, because thou hast been faithful in a few little things, I will give you authority over 10 cities. Now we as Christians worldwide are persecuted. Now here in the South, we're not persecuted very much. Unless you go visit a guy and he and his wife down to their last beer and she's got it in her hand and fussing about it. You get pretty persecuted under those kind of circumstances. But under normal circumstances, I don't have to worry about leaving home and somebody shooting me because I'm a Christian. Or the authorities arresting me and hanging me on the courthouse square because I'm a Christian. No, those things don't exist here, but worldwide, that's not true. A lot of places, they would put you to death if you admitted being a Christian. Look at the scope of his reign. It will cover every nook and corner of the world. This is what Philippians said. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of the things in heaven and the things in earth and the things under the earth, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is to the glory of God and to the Father. Now the president don't know everything that's going on. Well, I guarantee you, even the police chief in Cortland, Alabama, didn't know Brother Elliott was breaking the speed limit when he came to him. He didn't know it. He didn't know it. They say, well, how did you know it? I broke it. The sheriff don't know everything that's going on. But you see, Jesus will know every single thing about everybody at all times. And the world will be a place of peace. The length of his reign is 1,000 years. 1,000 years he will reign. It will be a public honoring of God's Son. What's 1,000 years all about? It is about honoring Jesus Christ. When he was here the first time, he was crucified and treated badly. Now God is demanding something from this earth, and that is that they would honor the Lord Jesus Christ. Alvin York. Y'all ever heard the name Alvin York? He was from Tennessee, wasn't he? Tennessee, Maine.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, he lived in Pole, Tennessee. Anyway, he lived in the mountains. He was a hillbilly, and he lived in the mountains. They drafted him. After he got married, he got saved. They drafted him into the Army, World War I. He came back the national hero. They had parades in his honor. Everybody knew his name back then. Here, this little country boy that lived up in the mountains, all of a sudden was here he was, national attention as much as it could be back then. Folks, that's the way it was with the Lord Jesus Christ. As we honor him, those 1,000 years honor him. At last, the prayers of the saints will be honored. People everywhere have prayed, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Folks, that is the age we're praying about. That is the age that we're talking about. Now look at the conditions under the millennium reign. First of all, there's the conditions of the Jews. To try to win a Jewish person to the Lord nowadays is like trying to pull chicken's teeth. Just don't happen. They don't mind. The Bible says God has blinded their eyes. Evidently, he's saved them for this particular time in history. They are God's timetable. Now, a lot of folks try to do a lot of things, trying to figure time out. A little girl was putting our groceries in at Walmart, and the weather was warm. I said, sure it's warm today. She said, yeah, you know what the Bible says. Now, I don't know what the Bible says about being warm today, but I thought you were talking about the nature change. But that's not where you figure out. It is a prophecy of the Bible, and it is the nation of Israel. Watch them. Watch them. They are God's key to the prophecy. Now, the Jews had deep sorrow all their existence. They've been in wars and mistreated and everything. And God has blessed them and blessed them and blessed them. And he said, if you bless my people, I'll bless you. I don't want to get political here, but I'll tell you something. If we don't honor them as a nation, God not going to honor us. One of the things, the reason the economy is so good and everything is going so good now is because we're affiliating with them and honoring them. And God's keeping his promise. The temple will be rebuilt. And there's some question in my own mind as to when the temple will be rebuilt. Personally, I think it'll be before the rapture of the church. Not only that, I believe before the rapture of the church, the ark will be brought down. In 1919, it was discovered by a group of explorers on a mountain. They came back and told about it, how the cages was there for the animal. Here's what Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the day of the coming of the Son of Man. So I can see that ark being brought down. I wish man that no hair could live to walk through. But she didn't. There was that witness to folks. Will it make a difference? The temple will be rebuilt. Then let's look at the conditions of the earth. When Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, everything went bananas. The world got messed up. But in those days, in the Garden of Eden days, it did not rain. A mist came up from the earth and watered it. Everything was perfect. No tornadoes, no storms, anything like that. But when Adam fell, everything went to pieces. Johnson grass began to grow. How many of us country boys, older guys that chopped cotton, didn't get ill feet and tore it out? Every time you started digging up some Johnson grass, you had to dig and dig. And your thought was, well, Adam, if you hadn't messed up, I wouldn't be out here doing this. The animals will be changed. Now listen, the animals will be changed. That's what Isaiah said. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. As I read this, I thought about all those little babies we've got, all those little toddlers. Can't you just see one of them with a big old lion by the whiskers leading him around? And I read something. I've been reading this Bible for 52 years. And I read something this week. You know, animals kill each other. They eat the meat of other animals. Here's what the Bible says. And they will eat straw. The Bible's got everything covered. And they will eat straw. But look at the conditions of the people on the earth. Who will be living? Those who are not killed in the battle of Armageddon. And then the saints of God. Now, got to remember, we're not going to be flesh and blood like we are now. Okay, keep that in mind. Don't visualize yourself as being down here subject to temptation and all that. No, we will reign with him. We will rule in a theocracy. And you know, people tried everything in the world. Empires, republics, democracies. All have failed. Everything has failed. The democracy, we've had a democracy for a long time. But listen, democracy is like a body, and it will develop something wrong with it. Democracy has its own cancer that goes with it. I think it's the best form of government that we're capable of coming up with. But in that millennium reign, it will be a theocracy type government. There will be sin in the hearts of men. Not us now, come on now, we're saints of God. There will be sin in the hearts of men, but God, as I said before, will put it down immediately. There be no wars. The Bible said, the Prince of Peace. So this is what Isaiah said. And he shall judge among the nations, and shall rebuke many people, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nations, neither shall they learn war anymore. What are they doing? They're changing all the things that was made for war. They're changing it for peacetime. Now, I think there will be factories running. I think there will be car manufacturers. I think life will go on like it is, except we'll go on at a total different level. Different level. I think it will be the best that God could give human beings in with flesh and blood. We will have universal worship. Listen to this. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the feast of the tabernacle. In that day, all men will be compelled to worship God. Now, you don't have to go out and knock on somebody's door and say, listen, I want to invite you to come to this annual service we have. Brother, they'll be there. They'll be there. God has compelled them to be there. Well, there will not be any need for evangelism in that day, because here's the thing of it. Up until the very last, until Satan is turned loose at short season, they couldn't get saved anyway. You see, the reason Satan is turned loose is because people have to make a choice. Why are you saved? Because you made a choice. You made a choice between the devil and Jesus. Basically, that's about as simple as I can tell you about salvation. You just made a choice between the devil and the Lord Jesus Christ. So for 1,000 years, men have lived literally in the presence of God. Literally in the presence of God. They live where everything is as it should be. And so the angel unlocks the cage, the bottomless pit. Out comes Satan. He begins to deceive the people, Gog and Magog. What does that mean? Gog means man, and Magog means land in its original city. Later on, it came to mean a person and a nation. What he's saying is this. Not only, remember now, salvation in this case is personal. Not only will it be the individual that will try to defeat God, but it will be the nations that they're part of trying to defeat God. You say, boy, they got to be idiots. Who in the world could live during 1,000 years? Nobody's going to die during this 1,000 years. The population is going to explode. Can you imagine? Though there's not that many folks left on the earth after the Battle of Armageddon, you have those that are left. None of them's going to die. And you'll have great grandkids, sir. All these years, you've been living in the presence of God. You've been going up once a year and taking part of this great celebration God has. Now, who in the world in their right mind would go after Satan? Well, nobody in their right mind, but I'm absolutely convinced I didn't have my right mind when I got saved. And when you get born again and Jesus comes into your heart, that you begin to think different. But the army has one more chance, I think, to defeat God. They come up and the Bible says that some of them fall down on their knees and weep. They see the camp of the saints and they realize they made a mistake. But fire and brimstone comes down from heaven. Comes down from heaven and destroys them. I think there's one great principle taught here. And that's this. It does not matter what the man may be exposed to. He can be around miracles. He can be in a Christian family. He can be a silver spoon delivered to him in black. He can have it made. But let me tell you something. That won't save you.
Amen.
The Bible says, except you be born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. We've got this client friend, he's got a pet pig. I ain't going to call his name, he might be watching my video. He got this pet pig. drove by a couple of years ago, had that pet pig, had a red ribbon tied on his neck. Cutest little pig you ever saw. He's proud of that pig. Proud of that pig. But let me ask you a question. What would happen if you left the back door open and that pig got out? Yeah. We know what would happen, don't you? Man, he'd head for that mud hole. See, that's the way human nature is, unless we're changed. Unless the Holy Spirit of God has come into our life, we've been born again. All the exterior things that God can do for us won't save. There was an artist who was teaching a class on painting. They were painting a forest. And he had painted this beautiful picture of a forest. And then he started painting a road coming out. And he said to his class, when you draw a picture of a forest, always draw a picture of a road coming out. If you don't, people will feel like they're boxed in. Let me tell you, the road coming out is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's the road that's coming
Amen.
Out. There's no, Jesus, the Bible says there's no other way that we be saved except through Jesus Christ, what He did for us on the cross.
Amen.
You know what I like about being saved besides going to heaven? I like that especially. But I like the fact He holds me by the hand.
Amen.
Not only does He hold me by the hand, He holds me by the heart.
Amen.
Life ain't always easy. Things don't always go right. Sometimes I'm down and sometimes I'm up. Praise the Lord, I'm heavenly man.
Amen.
He gave me that experience.
Amen.
How can you enjoy that? How can you be part of that? If you're not saved, let me tell you, it's simple. It is simple, but it's profound. It is free, but it costs God everything.
Amen.
All He asks you to do is confess your sins to Him and invite Him to your heart. How much simpler could it be than that? That is simple. Let's have an invitation. And sometimes, you know, we need to come and pray and ask God to help us. We need to come and pray at all. Sometimes the people that we know, the people we love, they get sick. And they need our prayer. They need our prayer. God still works miracles. Now, you can't, don't put God in no cage of modern day. God still works miracles. Most of the miracles God works, you'll never know them in your lifetime that He did for you. Sometimes, God lets us see them and God lets us know when you're praying for somebody. And the doctor says there's no way that yet they live. We know a miracle has taken place. Let's bow our heads together now. Blessed Heavenly Father, dear God, we're so grateful for Jesus Christ. We're so grateful, God, for what He did for us on the cross. And Lord, we're so grateful for what history holds for us. We know, God, as time progresses on, we're going to lay in the grave someday. We're going to be cremated. Our body's going to be eaten or lost. We're not going to be here for one reason or other. But God, we know that our soul is eternal. And He's going to spend eternity on the place of life. God, as we sing the invitation, let us look at our relationship to the Lord. In this crucial example, God, am I right with the Lord? Where will I go when I die? Now, Lord, I pray the Holy Spirit will convict us of our needs. And I pray the Lord that we'll respond to whatever You have us do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Stand together.